Delighted to welcome you all tonight to the Redelta Pumps talk on efficient pump design systems and technologies. We will have four speakers this evening. They are Bart Essink, who is head of sales at Redelta, Edwin McHielsen, who is a design and marketing engineer, Ronald Dickiers, who is team leader in hydraulics and design, and Dr. Lars Krakers, who is hydraulic and design engineer. Before I pass over, I'd just like to say for questions, please do put them into the question and answers box and not into the chat. I'd encourage you all to use the chat for a general discussion to introduce yourselves, keeping everything as friendly as possible. But please do use the Q&A for any questions. With that said, I'll now pass it over to Bart to begin the presentation proper. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks for participating in today's Zoom meeting. Subject is efficient pump design and system and technologies. A special thanks goes out to the Engineers Island, to John and Gerard for organizing, and of course inviting us to do our presentation. Today we want to discuss the development and selection of pumps, the fish-friendly standards, and also the hydraulic designs. So before I give a word to my colleagues to discuss in more detail, I'd like to spend a few minutes to explain the background of our company. So we are Redelta. We started off in 1946 as Delta Pompen. At that time, we were a production facility. And throughout the, I would say, this year we have the 75th anniversary. So throughout the year, we changed a little bit on let's say our focus. So first, as a production facility, we had to focus on nice subjects like Six Sigma and lean manufacturing, and it was all to get the speed and to get low pricing. Throughout the years, and that started off when we became Sulzer Delta, we did more of the API pumps. And then in 2004, we became Redelta. And in 2015, also KBL took over our company, and we became more like an engineered company. And the biggest change we have between a production facility and an engineered company is actually the focus we have. So for a production facility, we a lot of times had to go into the market with our product. So basically we could sell whatever we had available in our factory. So when changing to an engineered company, we were able to propose a fit for solution option to the customer. So this was not based or dictated on a market being going to low cost countries or just providing whatever was available, but also listen to the customer and hear what they what the need was. So not changing their, let's say, requirements, but adopting the requirements to our products. And besides entering a new market, it also means that the colleagues we now have, and which you will see in the next few, minutes or the next hour, they will explain more about the knowledge and also about the new requirements into the market. So this is not only a pump bringing fluid from A to B, but also fish friendliness and of course, building a green product, because this is also adapting to the future needs. So being a little a step ahead, and what we normally mention, it's a little bit behind me, but if distinctive vision, this is something Redelta wants to be recognized on. And hopefully today we can show some of our capabilities throughout the different sessions we have. That being said, I'd like to give the word to my colleague, Edwin. will explain more about the development and the selections of pumps.
Hello, I'm Edwin Magielsen. I'm the design and marketing engineer of RoDelta. And today I'd like you to tell you more about our product. And this is a pump. Most of us maybe know a little bit what a pump is. Mostly it's driven by a motor, can be an electrical motor, but also a diesel motor. And then you have the pump shaft who gets to the impeller. And the impeller is inside of the volute, and through the rotation of the impeller, the fluid will grow through the pump and reach more pressure so that it do its function for pumping. In RoDelta, we have a lot of different products. Even if you go to our website, you can see a lot of products. But this is not the meaning of this presentation is not to show you all our products as well as the philosophy behind our products, because we believe that still the pump is already for many years known. There is a lot of possibilities to make it better and even to use it in a better way. As RoDelta, we also make our API products, the API pumps. And this means these are pumps for the American Petrol Institute and the number 610, that's for the centrifugal pumps. And these pumps normally will be used in refineries and oil and gas plants. And we have developed a pump range from the OH2 to OH5. And this are OH2, for example, is the pump you see on the side of me on the skid, and on this the other one is OH5. It's a vertical inline pump, and these pumps normally have a volute instead of diffusers. What we have done inside of RoDelta is the volute casing, what you see on the left, is into the impeller is into it, and on the other side you see a diffuser casing. Actually, to create a whole range of pumps, we only have one casing, and inside of it, we create different diffusers. What these diffusers do is that where you normally need a volute for a pump to get pressure in it, you can also do it by a diffuser, which is on the right. And to get an ideal, a good product, there is only one specific point where the match with the volute and the impeller is on its best. To get the best product in the market for these best efficiency point, you normally have to build maybe 10,000 volutes to have the right volute for your need. Instead of that, we designed a casing which is for a whole range of diffusers the same. So we only match it, do it with the vanes inside of this volute diffuser part, which takes over the volute. So instead of a lot of different volutes, you can do that by machining a diffuser. Only that's not enough, because then you only have the casing done, but you can also use the impeller for a more optical optimum way. So to go to the impeller, we also created 78 different impellers. And all impellers are made with 13 specific speeds. These are the differences between in a value of in an impeller, which Ronald Dijkers further up will explain how this functions. But to create an optimum, we can also cut a little bit from the impeller to make them fit around the diffuser. And the combination of that creates an optimum to work with. So the efficiency of these products is optimum in the market for these kind of pumps. If you have done this optimization for the impeller and the diffuser, Then there is also an inlet. So how you can get the most optimum to get the fluid into your eye of the impeller. At Redelta, we have searched for an optimum way, and we find a solution in an optimum, as you see on the right side. This is something where the fluid goes in, goes out through a kind of a bubble, which is in the middle of the suction pipe. And around it, the floating pads are equal so that it comes straight into the eye of the impeller. So you see that also by a pump like this, there is many things to improve to get a more optimum pump and overall more efficiency, so a better product in the market for your use. And normally in this market, efficiency is not so important, but you see more and more with the green awareness that also these kind of companies are looking for products which can get the optimum out of it. At Redelta, we go further on. So we also think about your product management. So if we develop something like this OH5 pump, we also created this template option. What does this template option do? Normally you see a schedule from the timeline. Normally you have the dark blue stripe. This is 28 production lead time for our product. And afterwards you have to do your piping work on site. To create this template, which we already can supply in 6 weeks, then you see that the delay which you have in your product can be compromised because you can already start with your piping work in the times that you normally have to wait for your pump to get ready on site. This yellow part we can supply in 6 weeks, like I said, but there is also a second one, which you can also do the pressure test on your piping. So instead of waiting until everything is there, you have to take away your pump to do the pressure test. Then you can keep everything in place. You can do everything, your pressure test, until everything is finished. Then resupply your pump. The only thing you have to do, take out the yellow part and put in the original pump. In this way, you can save time, not only in the lead time of your product, but also save time, which is maybe not going well in the beginning of your project, and bring it back on schedule. These are kind of things we are always looking at. And also, like I mentioned, efficiency, which is important. And we see in the market that a lot of people talking about efficiencies and think that this is everything what we need, and more is not there. And we see for efficiency that also European Union is looking for things to get a greener world and make a minimum efficiency index. And this is done in the Europump, number 547. And there they have talked about that, for example, the pump has always to have an efficiency of 90%. A lot of competitors in the market use a pump which they speed up, because if you put a higher speed in your pump, the efficiency will be very good on one point in the curve, and they cut off what you see next to me, this blue spots, they cut off from the pump. But then your pump have good efficiency and is small, so very cheap to buy. So if you look to the price-wise and efficiency, you will say, okay, that's a good solution. I will choose this solution. But you have to know, if you have a piping system, so the total system, then the fluid is going through the system with a maximum speed of 4 meters or 5 meters per second. If you go higher, you will get cavitation in your piping work, and this will lead to heavy noise, but also shaking of your system, and leads to problems with your piping work in the near future. So actually, to go down, you need to have a pipe again to get the speed out of the pump back to the speed of 4 meters per second. Instead of doing this, you can also choose for a pump with a lower flow inside of it and a more optimum to get this pump work in this area for 4 meters per second. So you can imagine if we see in the market sometimes pictures, then we see this kind of things. You see this, this means that somebody gets to reduce the speed from the pump again. And to reduce it, they put these reducers in it to lower the speed back to this 4 meters per second. But these can bring 10% of your efficiency losses again back. So you think you have a 90% pump, but actually you have an 80% pump because your losses are not in the pump, but in your system to get back to the speed. So sometimes it looks like you have a good solution, but it isn't always the real result if you overlook the whole project. At Rodelta, we also have projects like concrete value pumps. And you would say, no, a lot of people think that we put pump concrete. This is not true. Our valued, what you see is the valued, and this is a part of it at the side of me and at that side. And we create this part of the valued. We can bring it to the building where you create it, and then it will be poured totally into concrete. What is the good thing about this? If you work with salt water or something, then you don't have to have so much cost in the outside of the pump valued because the material is concrete, quite cheap. And normally if you go to seawater constructions, you have to go to duplex or even to super duplex, which is very expensive. So overall, we see again here, the price could be a little bit higher for the investment in the beginning to put the pump over there, but your total cost of ownership, if you look to the whole system, is much cheaper. These kind of pumps are well known in the Netherlands. Also, already in 1930, they started with concrete value pumps. And when they take out old pumps like this, and you look to the concrete value parts, they are really in good condition and you can use them like it was last year produced. So very good experience are over here. Mostly they are used in the beginning for irrigation, but more and more we see for power plants that they start to use these concrete value pumps instead of vertical turbine pumps. If you look at a vertical turbine pump, there are many parts on it, costly with all the wear parts where you have. A concrete value pump instead of this is really a saving in your total cost of ownership if you look over the whole lifespan of a pump like this. Normally, we can go with these pumps for 30, 40 years without any problem. Rodelta also produced a smaller type of pump for this. And this is actually quite different kind of type. You never see it so much. This is not with a volute like you saw before, but this is actually a volute what they stretched out into the height, and there is a spiral who guides the water along through the volute. This means that your pumping station can be built very small, and it saves in cost of that, but not only that, this is also a very very good product for the market for irrigation. In the past, we created these pumps with the normal actual impeller, actual flow, but more and more we get aware of the fish friendliness of pumps, and it's also possible now that we create an impeller. And if I see this pump, the first thing I also was thinking, how could this be fish friendly? Because you think it's more like, it hits you and then you're definitely dead. But the idea behind it will be explained by Lars Krakers later on in this production. There is also a NEM norm for these kind of products where Rodelta was one of the people who are involved in it. So at the moment, this norm will also go to a European norm so that everybody can use the ideas behind it, and that you can match or validate different kind of pump builders on really numbers, if it is really the product what you need and not the nice story what they are telling. Then I will show you another small thing what we have done here at Rodelta. Normally we have these, in Holland they call it a catback pump, but mostly they are known as an elbow pump. And these pumps are actually normally on a dike. So if there is any problem and you get losses of energy, then the pump will go out, the air will come on top of the pump, and the water will flow on both sides, so no valve is needed. We had also an inquiry for this at Rodelta. At Rodelta, we had to create a pump, which they asked us, could you make a pump which goes two sides? So you can pump in and pump out with the same pump. And we have overlooked this, and we came to a design to make a bi-directional pump. And this bi-directional pump you see over here is, first we did a performance measure around the system which was already there. We looked how the system was functioning. Then we created a new impeller with our CFD program. And then we created the pump in total. And we did also the calculations on it, that it is for the stiffness and everything was okay. Then we created the pump parts, and what quite big parts, because the impeller was already 2.40 meters. And on the end, we built these pump, and we built them three. And in a very short notice, in a short time, we did this. We started in May with the engineering of it. And in December, we already had three of these pumps overhanded to our customer. I know this is a very short introduction for what we did as Rodelta. There's much more to find on our website. We have an interactional website. If you go there and on every product, you can link through more information about it. There are brochures. If you go down to the bottom, you can download these brochures. We actually have one for the API market for oil and gas. We have one for more information about pumping stations, and we have one for drinking water. And now I give the word to Ronald Dijkers, and he will tell you more about the hydraulics from pumps.
Dankjewel, Edwin. Thank you, Edwin. Hi, my name is Ronald. I'm the head of the enthusiastic group of engineers at Rodelta, who are responsible for the hydraulic and mechanical design. And today, I will tell something about the pump hydraulic design aspects. So, first, I will do some theory about the pumps. Something else, velocity triangles. We go to the pump specific speed performance curve and cavitation. And then I will be able to show you some examples. And then afterwards, I hope you will remember some of the specific items with respect to what a pump can do and where to focus on when you see a pump performing. So yeah, a pump is a rotating machine in which the flow and pressure are generated dynamically. So there's no wall between the inlet and the outlet of the pump. And as shown before, and also shown in the picture here, there's an impeller in which the fluid is drawn from the suction side, and it's thrown outwards to generate pressure. And this pressure is generated through increase in velocity of the fluid. And when the fluid exits the impeller. It's drawn into the volute, and the volute is used to increase the pressure furthermore by transforming kinetic energy in static energy. And I showed before some of, a design strategy may be reduce the exit diameter of your volute, so because the total head is always considered, which is the static head plus the dynamic head. And if you do not transform your dynamic head into static head, you cannot also, you will not lose any efficiency, because transforming dynamic head into static head with a diffuser always results in losses. And then I wanted to tell you, remember please, that a pump is used to increase the pressure in the fluid so that it can be transported to overcome system losses or static heads. And instead of pressure, we use the term head. So why do we use head instead of pressure? The head is the pressure divided by rho g, by the specific gravity of the fluid. And this makes the performance of the pump. So the head of the head generated by a pump is independent of the fluid properties. The pressure generated by a pump is dependent on the fluid properties, but we take the fluid properties out and we use the head. The head is proportional to the diameter squared and the pump speed squared. So a head we call h, the diameter of the impeller is d, n is the rotational speed. And on the next slide, we will show that the main parameter is the tangential velocity at the outlet of the impeller. And therefore I've drawn three pictures. In the middle, you see a three-dimensional image of a pump impeller. And of this same impeller, we on the left side, we have a marginal view of the pump impeller. And on the right-hand side, we see a top view of the pump impeller, where the gray line is the impeller blade. And what we do during our work is trying to find the optimum shapes for the marginal view and for the blade shapes to create a pump performance. And the pump performance is shown on the left-hand side is the rotational speed U2, which is the rotational speed times the radius at the outlet of the impeller blade, times the tangential velocity of the fluid at the exit of the impeller, which is C2U. And it's already a long time ago, Mr. Euler, he defined the Euler head, which says that the head is U2 times C2U divided by G. And how can we determine C2U? Well, for that we use the blade angles. You see here an impeller which is rotating to the left, and we have backward curved fins. And at the inlet you see a blade angle beta 1, and at the outlet you see a beta 2. And these blade angles beta, they can be determined from the radius, the speed, and the flow rate, and the width of the impeller. So the marginal velocities are drawn on the left side in light blue arrows. And the same arrows are also shown in the right-hand side at the inlet and the outlet. So the marginal velocity is a function of the width of the impeller, the position, the radial position, which is shown as D, but and then the width of the impeller at this radial position. And so at the outlet of the impeller, you see blue lines of the meridian of velocity Cm. And also, if we assume that the fluid at the exit of the impeller, the relative velocity, that's always the difficulty with pump impeller design. We have a relative velocity and we have an absolute velocity. But if we look to the in a relative plane of of our impeller, then we so we assume there's no we do not assume, but we travel along with the rotating impeller, then the flow will exit the impeller having the same direction as the beta 2 direction at the exit of the impeller. Further, we know that it will have a marginal velocity Cm. And from these two properties, the Cm2 and the beta 2, we can derive the value of W2u, so which is the tangential relative velocity. And then if we want to know the absolute tangential velocity, which is the rotational velocity u2 minus the relative velocity W2u. Oh my God. On the left lower corner, I've written down, so you can see that the head is a function of the rotational speed u, the marginal velocity, and the tangent, the blade angle beta 2. And so I've written down, if we increase the flow rate, the marginal velocity will go down, the tangential velocity in relative plane will go up, the absolute tangential velocity in the absolute plane will go down, and therefore the head will go down. So that is how we can come to the shape of the pump curve. That's the outlet, but then the inlet, we also have to reposition the leading edge of the impeller blade. And then we have to also use the marginal velocity, the position of the leading edge, and the three-dimensional effects which are there, the thickness of the blade, to determine the correct blade angle beta 1 to find the optimum flow path around the blade. And on the next slide, you will see the pump curve is a curve that says how the head varies for the varying flow rates with a constant pump speed and a fixed impeller diameter. And when is a pump good? That depends on the interaction between the pump and the system. I've shown here also the pump and its system, where you see that the pump will deliver a head, and the flow rate it will deliver, and the head, the actual head it will deliver, are depending on the system it has to overcome. So the system resistance. System resistance is the static head plus the losses. And you see on the right hand side two cases which have the same static head. But the difference is that the inlet pressure at the both pumps are different, because that's also an important parameter, which inlet pressure is present at the pump, because at lower inlet pressures, you might have, or you will have more cavitation, and more on that later. So always, if you want to decrease pump power consumption, mostly it is please decrease your resistance losses in your system. We talked a little bit about velocity triangles to explain the shape of the head curve. But with this example or this exercise, I want to explain something about pump specific speed. So I've drawn here again the marginal shape of a pump impeller. This time we have a diameter D1. And we assume a constant head and flow rate. The width of the impeller times the diameter is constant, and we have constant blade angle from inlet to outlet. And then we are cutting down from D1 to D2. And so we reduce the diameter. With the above assumptions, we can then determine that the marginal velocity will not change from D1 to D2 because D times B is constant. And this is, and also Q is constant. So the CM1 is CM2. And as we already explained, that the head is relative to U times U minus CM divided by the tangent of the blade angle. We need to make sure that the tip speed of the impeller at the outer diameter of the pump of the impeller for H1 and H2 or two cases, D1 and D2, need to be the same. So in that case, we will need to make sure that the speed at D2 is two times the speed needed for the case D1. So N2 is two times N1. So what we in fact see is that the specific speed of the second case is two times the specific speed, pump specific speed of the first case. So for the same flow and head, this pump speed needs to be twice as high. And yeah, why is that such a thing? That we think we can see on the next slide. Because if, let's say if we, you see on the left side, a very, let's say, narrow outlet width impeller, which is a very low specific speed, which means that you need a very low speed to give the same head and flow as for a very high specific speed. But the dimensionless number for specific speed is omega times the square root of the flow rate divided by GH to the power 0.75. And then we have a pump specific speed range between 0.08, which is as low as we can get with centrifugal impellers, up to specific speeds of 10, where each of these pumps have their own characteristics, but on the lower row, you can read the maximum attainable efficiencies, which Mr. Anderson from the UK has determined like 50, 60 years ago, that for very low specific speeds, you will not get as high as a maximum attainable efficiency as for a specific speed of 1, where the approximate optimum is. And if we go higher in specific speeds, we can again go down in the maximum attainable efficiency. Also, you see that for the very low specific speeds, as was shown earlier by Edwin, a diffuser design is the most optimum. For the average specific speeds, mostly volute designs are optimum. And then again, for the very high specific speeds, way of axial flow impellers, again, then we do use them mixed flow or axial flow diffusers to transform the kinetic energy into static energy. So yeah, what do we do when we do hydraulic design at Rho Delta? We use parametric parameterized impeller and volume geometries, diffusion geometries, which we put into a design space where we try to find the optimum for a kind of a cost function, because you cannot only optimize for efficiency. There are much more parameters which need to be taken into account, like the steepness of the QH curve, the minimum flow, flow phenomena which might occur, which you want to make sure that you do not have too much vibrations at the lower flow rates due to recirculations that occur at lower flow rates. And also cavitation is a very important parameter. So with the non-linear behavior of all the flow phenomena that occur in the multi-dimensional design space, it's a very challenging task, which is at the same time, for us, we like to do that. And also, you need to be sure when you design that you understand all the different aspects of all the different losses that can occur. So, as told, the optimum for us high efficiency is with specific speeds between 1 and 2. So would you normally choose a specific speed of 1 to 2? I think most of the standard pumps, they have specific speeds lower than 1. And for higher or lower heads, the specific speeds are higher. But why are they not always at the highest speed? That is due to cavitation. Cavitation is the occurrence and implosion of vapor sheets in the pump due to the high velocities of the fluid, which may occur at the inlet where the pressure of the fluid is still very low. And we consider cavitation as the limiting factor in the choice of pump operation, but also in design. Thanks to cavitation, we have 4 or 5 hydraulics working on pump design, because it really determines the success of your pump. Let's go into cavitation. So what you see here, this is what looks like a very simple calculation. It's done quite a few years ago, like 10 years ago, but it should be a uniform or a steady calculation. So this is a CFD calculation, which just assumes a steady flow at the inlet at the left side of this computational domain, with a uniform velocity field at the inlet. It attacks an, can we go back? I'm not that fast. It attacks a two-dimensional profile of a vane. And what you see here is that the vapor, the void fraction is going red, where the void fraction is very high. And in fact, this is cavitation. And so it appears that the steady state is not steady. And what you see here looks very slow, but in fact, this is only happening in a few nanoseconds. So the time scale is very, very, very short. And also, it's a very complex calculation. And if we look to this profile from above, there were also done some high-speed camera video recordings, where you also see that the cavitation which is occurring is far from stable. And again, time scales are very, very short. And unluckily, we cannot use these very short time scales during our design process. But what can we do? We can, with our tools, we can predict the occurrence of sheet cavitation in pumps, and especially in impellers, And that's also what we calculate for all pump designs, in which we can calculate the effect of this cavitation on the pump performance. And which performance is that we can predict? Well, we can predict the decrease in performance with respect to head and also the change in power, and so the effect on the efficiency of the pump, depending on the amount of cavitation that is occurring. But as you have seen, it is a very time-dependent phenomena, so unsteady phenomena, which will increase the noise and also vibration levels. And as you can see on the right-hand side, also material erosion is a phenomenon that is caused by cavitation. Again, a little theory on cavitation, which is the MPSH. So the difference between the static pressure at the pump inlet plus the velocity at the inlet of a pump, that is the total pressure minus the vapor pressure, is the difference, is the netto positive suction head. And there are two netto positive suction heads. One is the system netto positive suction head. So it's system dependent, and the one system has higher MPSH values than the other system, which determines whether or not you can select a pump at a higher or lower speed. But the pump MPSH required is a pump dependent parameter independent of the fluid. And there are different criteria at which the pump MPSH curve can be shown, and these are often the 3% head drop, but it may also be based on the length of a cavitation or 0% head drop, whatever is needed. But we need to make sure that the MPSH available is higher than the MPSH required. So on the right-hand side, you see here for one pump, three MPSH curves, again, for a fixed speed, a fixed impeller diameter, the variation in flow will show that there is depending on the criterion, an optimum for the MPSH required. So we have an inception curve, which is the highest curve. So above if the green line, which is the MPSH available, is above the MPSH required line, then at least if it's above the inception line, then we do not have cavitation. So in this case, we would only have on one point, we would not have no cavitation at all. And in the industry, we use 3%. So we have it, the Q is 90% of the best efficiency point. We have 1.1 meter difference. And for instance, for the petroleum market API pumps, they ask 1 meter difference. So in this case, that would be acceptable for flows up to 90% of best efficiency point. I made a design example showing you if we require 10,000 cubic meters at 15 meters of head, MPSH available is 12 meters. This is typical for an open water pump where the impeller is 2 meters underwater. You can select pumps at different speeds, and they will result in different pumps with different specific speeds. So I've used specific speeds designs of 0.5, 1.5, 2.5, 3.5, 4.5. You see the increase in speed, but mention the difference in impeller outer diameter between the maximum and minimum is a factor of more than 4. So, almost 4. So that's quite a lot. But at the same time, the difference in factor of MPSH required is more than 17. So if we have 12 meters available, then probably you would end up with a maximum allowable specific speed of 50 meters of head of approximately 2.5. And this is also what we see in practice. So so you're limited in your choice of your specific speed. Last example is a very old case that I presented like 20 years ago. But it shows you a very high power pump, 40 megawatts, using two-stage impellers, two suction impellers, double suction impellers. The MPSH available was more than two times the MPSH required, but still after 1 year of operation, you see already the erosion has come to such extent that there were holes in the impeller. So what we did CFD analysis of the existing design impeller, but also we did quite extensive testing of the existing design impeller to see that in the whole operating range, which is here indicated between 3900 cubic meters per hour, there is cavitation. There was only five impeller blades. They were heavily loaded, and these made sure that the impeller was worn out within 1 year of operation. And on the right hand side, you see the new design impeller, which was seven blades, which I remember many colleagues say, if you want to decrease MPSH, you need to go to less vanes and not more. But it's not all about 3% MPSH. It's in this case, with such a high energy content, it's about designing for cavitation-free operation. The difficulty with these curves is there are so many curves, but as you can see on the right-hand side, the green line, horizontal green line at 124 meters is below the the middle one with the crosses, visual cavitation pressure side and visual cavitation suction side, which are the lines with the black lines with the crosses. So remember on the left hand side we have the operation erosion after 1 year of operation. On the right hand side is the impeller after 2 years of operation, and the impeller was perfectly worn out. I think my colleagues are happy to see that I'm at the last slide. So I don't know about my audience, but I hope you will remember some of the items that were shown about pump design. It's not all about optimization of efficiency, but also remember cavitation and the effect it has on pump performance. Thank you very much. Go to our tool.
Okay. Good evening. My name is Lars Krakers. I'm a hydraulic and mechanical engineer at Rodelta. Before I worked at Rodelta, I worked for 10 years at Flowserve, and I was also responsible for a fish-friendly project. And I will talk in this presentation about fish passable pumps. The content of my presentation is that I will start with a short introduction and design philosophy. Then I will talk about survival rate, how to predict that, and how you can test it. Then I will show something about the standard where this survival rates are incorporated. And then I will show some examples of fish passable pumps and some concluding remarks. As introduction, for the survival of many fish species, migration between wetlands and different wetlands is a necessity. For example, you have eel, which has to reproduce itself. They have to swim from the wetlands in Europe to the Sargasso Sea, And when they do this journey, they have to pass many barriers, like pumping stations. So in the middle, you see the Netherlands, and a large part is below sea level. And because of that, there are many pumping stations in the Netherlands, and that's difficult to overcome for fish when they have to travel. On the right side, you see a lot of dots, and all each of these dots are pumping stations. So they are barriers for fish migration. Not all pumps are on fish migration routes, so not for every pumping station a fish-friendly pump is necessary. At the moment, there's an increased focus on the environment. So from the European Union, there are now laws to improve the fish migration. And that gives a market for fish passable pumps. How can you do overcome these migration barriers? There are different solutions. So for the first one, you can see fish stairs or fish siphons through a dike. And these are quite expensive civil works, which have to be built. And they also introduce leakage. So it will give you an efficiency loss for your pumping station. Besides that, it's also possible to try to prevent that fish come into your pump. So there are systems like stroboscopic lights or acoustic barriers, fixed screens or bubble curtains. But then if you use these systems, there will be no migration. So you have to always to combine it with the fish passage systems, like number one. But then besides these two solutions, you can also try to make the pump station itself fish passable. And then you have to talk about survival rates of pumps. A design philosophy for fish passable pumps would be the bigger the better, because a big impeller will rotate at a lower speed, and then the hit strike velocity of the impeller blade with fish will be lower, and it also has large openings. In the Netherlands, we have pumping stations in a large variety of capacity, but always with low heads, and because of that, the waterboard select pump pumps. On purchase price, and that means that you will select axial flow pumps, which in the end are the smallest pumps and run at the highest speed. So in the end, these pumps are not fish friendly at all. One of the solutions would be to improve the survival rate of a pump, to select a pump which is larger than would be required if you only would buy it for purchase price. So it will run at lower speed. And that will give higher survival rates and also a longer lifetime of the pump. A disadvantage is, of course, then the higher purchase price. But a second solution would be that you improve the survival rate by redesigning your pump design. Okay. And if you want to do that, then you have to look into the survival rate of a pump. And We developed a kind of a survival rate prediction together with other pump manufacturers. And it gives you the survival rate as a formula, which is 100% and then minus the mortality rate of the impeller. And the mortality rate of the impeller is dependent on the strike velocity and the strike probability with the leading edge of the impeller. Then you have also the influence of the diffuser, which also has an influence of the strike probability and the strike velocity on the diffuser blade, except that these blades are standing still, so the strike velocity is much less than from the impeller. So this is effect is also much smaller. You can also have pumps where the impeller rotates directly in front of the diffuser blade. So you can have a kind of scissor effect. So that can be a part of the mortality rate. So if you move the diffuser blade away from the impeller, this effect will become zero. Then there are also flow dependent phenomena which are influenced on the mortality rate. So you can have cavitation, recirculation flow, turbulence, and large shear velocities. And then there are also some structural effects, like the, if there are sharp edges where fish can bump into, or that will also give mortality rate. But the most important one is the impeller. And if we look more closely to the impeller, you can estimate the mortality rate of the impeller, like damage is the probability times the effect. So So if we start with the probability, the strike probability of the leading edge of the impeller, you can see that as the time a fish needs to pass along the leading edge surface of the impeller, divided by the time a blade needs to rotate it one blade pitch. And yeah, that gives you then in basic the strike probability. In the end, there are also some other factors in it. Fish will have maybe some relative speed with respect to water, and also fish dimensions can come into account. And that makes the equation a little bit more difficult, but in the basic, this is the strike probability equation. Then you have also the effect. So the effect is expressed as a mortality rate factor. And this mortality rate factor is given as an equation as a constant times the strike velocity minus the critical strike velocity. And this constant is dependent on the fish length with respect to the blade thickness. So in the figure left below, you can see that thick blades will have lower strike mortality than thin blades, which cut more like a knife. And it's also dependent then on the critical speed for the fish type. The strike velocity itself will be dependent on the shape of the leading edge. The strike velocity is then the perpendicular hitting speed. So when we make the leading edge forward swept, it means that the perpendicular hitting speed will reduce. So for fish-friendly impellers, you quite often will see forward swept leading edges. So at Redelta, we do engineered solutions. So we have made an in-house multidisciplinary design tool for impellers. And that's, like Ronald already said, is optimizing the head and flow efficiency and cavitation. But we also include now the survival rate of the impeller. So that will be the leading edge shape and the number of feints. And then we have to design this in a design space for an existing pump, if we do a retrofit or we make a new design. One of the most famous fish-friendly impellers is the Hydrostal screw impeller, which was invented by Martin Stahler in 1963. So this patent is already now expired. But so you see now a lot of companies who will use this impeller for the fish-friendly pumps. And when you look to this design, you will see that it has a single vane. So it means that the probability to hit is low because it's only one vane. It has a forward swept leading edge, like I explained also in the formula. It's a non-glogging design, so the fish will not bump into any structural parts. It has a small diameter, so the axial flow through the eye inlet is quite high. So it means that the time to pass the impeller inlet plane is small, and that will increase the survival rate. It's a mixed flow impeller, so it will rotate relatively at a lower speed, and that also will help the survival rate. And then the sharp pointy leading edge, it's running behind an edge at the front. And it's a volute design, so we only have one tongue and not many diffuser blades. So all in all the aspects which you can see from the survival rate formula are really well incorporated into this pump design. You can also test the fish survival rate. You can do that by field testing or laboratory testing. When you do field testing, it means that you have to record the pump settings, so the pump speed and the head and the flow. In the field testing, you are dependent on the natural supply of fish. That means that you will have long test times. So and then you have to make sure that fish will not get damaged in the nets where you collect the fish. After the test, you have to measure the length of the type of the fish, and you count the number of dead, damaged and undamaged fish. This method will test on the complete pump station, so including a trash rack and valves. So not only the pump. And this method will also include ecological aspects, so like the difference between fish species, the swimming direction of fish, and so on. For laboratory testing, it will require a permit to do the testing with live animals. and again, you have to record the pump speed, head and flow.
Now you have a controlled inlet, so you can do a much shorter test. And with controlled groups, you can make groups of certain lengths and certain species. Yeah, you can hold the fish for 72 hours after the test for delayed injuries and deaths and so on. And in this test setup, you will only test the pump. So these two, and the survival rate prediction formula and the test methods, they are incorporated in a standard, a Dutch standard. So it has these three items. It was published in May 2020, and it can be used by water boards in the Netherlands when they want to specify a fish-friendly pump. So the water board then has to set a survival rate, and that depends on the pumping station where it is. If it's very important, you have to have set a high survival rate, but sometimes it can be lower. High survival rates will mean more expensive pumps. And then the standard will only tell how you can prove the survival rate, so by calculating it or by testing it. So pump is nothing fish-friendly according to standard. It's just a method to prove the survival rate. And currently we are processing this standard to a European standard. So there are many examples. So in this slide, you can see two graphs. On the left, you can see it for scale fish, and on the right, you can see it for eel. At the bottom, you see many different types of pumps. And on the vertical shaft, you see the survival rate for these type of pumps. And then there are two columns. One is measured, and the other one is calculated by the prediction formula. And then you have the yellow and the green boxes. They are a laboratory test. So the yellow is for the axial flow concrete volume pump, and the green box is for the mixed flow concrete volume pump, as with a fish-friendly design. And then the purple one is our field test on pumping stations in the field. What you can see also is that for the purple one, you can see pumping station Katwijk, which is the most left in the purple area, which has a very high survival rate, and it's not a fish-friendly design. And yeah, I will show some pictures of these pumping stations, and I will explain better. There were pumping stations with axial flow, which we had very poor survival rates, where you can see in the middle picture, which has a four-blade impeller and a two-blade diffuser behind it. And then this was redesigned to the design which is on the left, which is a two-fane impeller with this forward swept leading edge, and there's no diffuser fane anymore. And then you can see that it will increase the survival rate. Then we also saw that a pump in the field, which is a conventional design, can also have very high survival rate. And that's a pump like you see in the picture on the right, which is at the pumping station IJmuiden, which has an impeller diameter of about 4 meters. So it runs at very low speed, and there were very large openings. And then also the survival rate can be very high. So there was also shown in the graph a testing of a fish-friendly design of a mixed flow impeller, which you see on the left. It has a kind of hydrostyle impeller now in the concrete volume pump. And this pump was tested with a model scale pump by company Bosman. And this proved to have also very good survival rates, even though it was tested with a very small scale pump. The pumping station Katwijk is also mixed flow with a conventional design, but again, it's a very large pump which has a diameter of 3.5 meters, which you see on the right. And then it also has very good survival rate. So high survival rate doesn't not mean that you have to have a fish-friendly design. It can also be a very big pump which runs at low speeds. There are also other solutions than centrifugal pumps. You can also have a Venturi pump, where you have a pump in the middle which pumps at high flow, and then you generate a low pressure at the valves in the middle. And then from the side channels, the fish can go sucked into this channel and then pass to the next level without passing through the pump. It's a quite complex system. I think I know one pumping station in the Netherlands where they applied it, but then I did not see it at more sites. And also another possibility would be Archimedes screw pumps. In this case, you will not increase pressure. It will just scoop the water with the fish and then it will travel it to the higher level. This is also a solution which can be very fish friendly. So some concluding remarks is that actually any pump can be fish possible, but then it depends of course on the pump size with respect to the fish size, the application and the operating conditions. But also any designed fish possible pump can also be a killing machine. When it runs at too high speeds, it will anyway kill the fish. So designed fish possible pump for the same operating conditions and the same size will perform better than conventional pumps. So that ends my presentation. And yeah, then we come to the questions, I think. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody. My name is Jared Nadel. I'm taking care of the questions and answers this afternoon. Start my video too, so you can see me. So we had a bunch of questions that came in. I was trying my best to break them out for the different individual people. So there's two questions, I think, Edwin, that are probably for yourself. Firstly, this is from Maxine, as regards wastewater treatment, which was, can the impeller slash casing be designed to achieve a free passage requirement and optimal energy efficiency?
Can you answer that? Can you repeat the question?
Sure. Can the impeller casing be designed to achieve a free passage requirement and optimal energy efficiency?
Well, mostly the limiting possible dimension is in the impeller, and the minimum dimension in the volute is mostly larger than in the impeller. So, and there are many impellers that are being designed to have a minimum passage, a ball passage, they call it. So yeah, but often it has a penalty in efficiency, for instance, because they use less blades, as you see with the fish-friendly impellers. Yeah. It always has a drawback, yes.
Another question from Alan, regarding pump efficiencies, and it's actually to do with a photo that was in the presentation. It says the photo on the right showed an eccentric reducer on the suction of the pump. Is this not for the elimination of air in the suction line rather than fitting a smaller pump?
If you would have a pump with the same diameter as at the non-reduced diameter of the suction pipe, it would also eliminate the air through the out of the suction piping. But I don't see that if you use a reducer, often they use a reducer in which they make certain that no air is entrapped by making an asymmetrical reducer at the pump inlet. But a pump without a reducer is causing less losses than a pump of a system with a reducer.
Yeah, so and that'll be true for both the exit and the inlet.
Yeah, so we prefer straight piping at minimum of 7 diameters in front of the pump for optimum pump performance.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let me see. This is one for Ronald. It's a CFD question. This is from Corn. I'm wondering how low fidelity RANS model predictions are validated with experimental data. So I guess ultimately the question is, how does the experimental data and the test data and the CFD data compare to each other?
Yeah, so they compare very well. I have this experience already for last 20 years that when you go into production, you may have production errors and you may have testing errors, but we have in the past, I've done some tests with very accurate produced impellers and volutes. And when we compare them, it is just one-on-one with 1-2% difference in the efficiency curves and in the power curves and in the head curves of and the MPSH curves of the pumps. Yeah.
We can very good.
Very good.
And basically also the I would say the CFD is also validated by the test, so it can be even modified with the test results. So calculations or formulas or whatever being used is, you know, validated during actual test. And then when it's scaled up, then we can use the same kind of experience.
So the challenges still are when you are trying to predict the behavior of a pump at part load, let's say at 20% of your best efficiency point, then you have recirculation areas. You have a non-uniform, a time-dependent flow patterns, which are constantly changing. And to accurately predict those phenomena with CFD is still challenging. When you want to accurately build up a CFD model with the capability to predict these phenomena, it costs you a lot of time and the accuracy is still doubtful.
But it's a balance between time and effort and results.
Yeah.
Probably another one for Ronald, because this is to do with MPSHA and MPSHR. I guess this is, this is for the, I think it was the very high pressure pump that you showed. In the example presented with the MPSHA being twice the MPSHR, was the MPSHR required of 54 meters, assuming 3% performance loss?
Yes, 3% head loss, yes.
And is there such a large difference between MPSHR at 3% and cavitation-free MPHR, which is about 70 meters in the example? So yeah, I would think it's that one there, yeah.
And I can go away as well. So you see here, the green line is the MPSH available. So the scales are different from left and right, but MPSH available 124 approximately. And then on the left-hand side, you see this lower, you don't see the arrow that I'm pointing at, but the lowest, pink purple line on the left picture with the round dots, it says 3% head drop. And you can see it's approximately 50 meters in the area from 3,000 to 5,000 cubic meters per hour.
Yeah, 3% is a industry standard, is that right?
That's the industry standard. When it all started, like after World War II, cavitation was not much of an issue. Previously, pumps were designed very conservative because, they were afraid of issues and they could not predict all the phenomena. And pumps were running relatively low. But then after World War II, slowly people found, hey, if we can make them run faster, then we have cheaper pumps. And then they found out, hey, if we just increase the inlet diameter, we have a lower MPSH 3%. We have more economic pumps. But then you have problems with pumps like these that occur. And so it's, especially for high energy pumps, you have to be careful with respect to cavitation and which MPSH criterion you use for your pump and your system.
Okay, great, thank you. Another one, sorry, a couple more. What is the difference between an API 610 pump and say an ISO standard pump?
Yeah, it's mainly about mechanical features that need to be there.
is there much difference in bearing lifetime? Not so much, but yeah, and generally the API pumps, all the steel is much thicker. That's one of the basic rules.
Performance requirements.
Yeah, and the performance requirements are a little bit more strict on the API. API, the book with requirements is much thicker than the book for the ISO pumps. So yeah. And,
cool.
And on top, often the customers, they have another book with requirements that's even thicker. And so when you want to when we sell an API pump, often it's more documentation than pump that we deliver. So that's
a lot is based on safe working and no failure of the system.
Yeah.
You see, so because they are used in processes which is very critical if something happens, and that's why all the materials is certified so that you know that the material is the right material and have the right forces, could have the right forces, and also on erosion of the material, that this will not bring a problem in the lifetime of these pumps. So all these kind of criteria are very high.
Mm. Excellent. Just the last question I really have here is, any words of advice on using variable speed drives with pumps?
Yeah, so variable speed drives, perhaps I can show that a little bit with this picture. So if you have a system curve with a very low static head, then let's say the static head is zero, then you have a system curve which goes to an operation point, and at flow zero, also your resistance loss is zero. But that means if you select a pump with zero static head and resistance intersection at the best efficient point, if you use then a variable speed drive, it will always run at the best efficiency point. So if you have a system with very large resistance losses, low static heads, yeah, please use a variable speed drive. And that is the most optimum case. You don't need to use any valves, or not any valves, but you do not need to regulate your flow with valves, but you can use then the variable speed drive, and always you will run at the best efficiency point of your pump. Good question.
There's questions coming in now. People are getting less. Jake has asked, do fish-friendly pumps allow fish to travel in both directions, i.e. from sea to inland and inland back to sea?
No, actually, the pump is designed to pump the water to the high level, so also the fish to the high level. If you want to do reverse, then usually they have a kind of outlet channel next to the pump itself.
If we look at this fish-friendly pump, it is also capable of acting as a turbine. So you can use it in both directions, but as you see, it is fish friendlier in the pump direction than in the turbine direction, because we have not made any special arrangements for the turbine. But if we would need to make this a fish friendly pump turbine, whoa, that would be another challenge for us.
Cool. Just a question as regards the last one here, as regards the, again, back to the high energy pump. So for the high energy pump with a very large NPSH margin, was the main cause of cavitation? What was the main cause of cavitation? Was it localized secondary flows and separation causing microcavitation?
Yeah. So I think I did not mention it. You have cavitation. So cavitation is the occurrence of vapor clouds and vapor sheets. But actually, when you hear cavitation, you hear the implosion of cavitation. And the implosion, if that occurs at the blade surface, that is where you have your cavitation erosion, assuming that the energy level is high enough. Because, yeah, I had a tutor, Paul Cooper, and he he's a very famous pump designer. He's now retired for 25 years already. But He told me once that in his young years, he was at a swimming pool and he heard a pump cavitating. He went to the owner and said, "Hey, do you know this pump is cavitating?" Yeah, and then the answer was, "Yeah." So what, already doing that for 15 years, and we'll do it for another 15 years. But yeah, so in this case, the energy level is such high, so high that it will have this effect on the pump, surface, that it has eroded within 1 year of operation. And I've not shown it, but also when we look at the prediction of the sheet cavity, you can see that it more or less is the same as the shape of the erosion that you see on the photo here.
And I'm just aware of the time, so the last question from Rory, it's actually kind of a product question for RoDelta. What is an acceptable turndown on your centrifugal pumps? Can it work below 50%? And I guess that's probably for any centrifugal pump.
Yeah, that's depending on the pump design. And again, you see, if we would stay at this example, very high energy application where, as we said, cavitation inception is an issue, it cannot. But if we go to, let's say, our diffuser pumps, the API pumps, they have a minimum continuous stable flow as low as 10% of best cavitation point. But again, that is the advantage of having a diffuser, which limits the radial loads, which limits the noise, which limits the vibrations. And also, yeah, this is API pump, it's quite sturdy. This can, so the pump lifetime is almost not decreased when it runs at only 10% of flow. Only below 10% we see some decrease in pump lifetime.
A story about the diffuser is on our website, where you can read a story about all the advantages of this technique in these type of pumps.
Mm.
And also, we did not show that. If you go, and we talked about specific speeds, I want to say that. So the API pumps, diffuser pumps, they are lower specific speeds. The higher specific speeds, already the minimum continuous flow where the pump can operate may be as high as 80%. So generally, lower specific speeds, you can go as down as 10% of the pump best efficiency flow. And this flow in general increases with the specific speed of the pumps. So that's one more reason to be careful with your choice of pump speed.
Excellent. And one very last quick question from Francis. Any problems with rodent damage to pumps?
Sorry, I don't think I understood.
Any problems with rats or anything causing damage to pumps, rodents?
No.
No. And the last thing I would say, actually, if you see in the chat there from David Kennedy, David Kidney, he was interested to hear that Anderson mentioned. Anderson mentored him when he worked for Weir Harland in Zambia in the late 1970s, designing mainly mine dewatering systems. So it's good to see that coming around. So that's it, everybody, for questions. We're just at 8 o'clock. I'll probably hand back to John here to finish things up, I guess.
Hi. Thank you very much to everyone, and thank you to Jer for fielding all the many, many questions, and thanks to all of you for being so engaged with it. What was a really great talk. All that's left for me to say is thank you very much to everyone from RoDelta for putting on a great talk, and thank you all for attending. I will hope to see you at our next event.